A very good morning to you. I welcome you to the first IC of the last day at Gurugram, glaucoma at crossroads. We have a keynote speaker. I'm privileged to invite Dr. Bipul Sarkar on stage. He's currently working as a glaucoma and cataract surgeon at Ispahani Islamia Eye Institute and Hospital, Bangladesh. He graduated from Rajshahi Medical College and thereafter completed his FCPS in ophthalmology and ICU exams UK. He pursued glaucoma fellowships at Ispahani Islamia Eye Institute and New York Eye and Ear Infirmary at Mount Sinai, USA. He has also done an observership at Aravind Eye Hospital, Madurai. He specializes in all complicated cataract and glaucoma surgeries, including implants and lasers, with a special interest in innovative modifications to make surgery safer and more effective. An excellent clinician and researcher with many publications to his credit, an esteemed teacher and guide. We are truly honored to have you today with us, sir. He will be talking on modifications to make trabeculectomy safer and more effective.
Hello. Yeah, very good morning. It's a great honor and my privilege to be here with you. And also I am grateful to AIOC to allow me to say something informed of you. Actually, today I am going to share my experience in modification of technique of trabeculectomy to build a safer surgical procedure. You know, glaucoma is the second leading cause of blindness. More than 50 million people are affected in the world, and over the 40 years of ages, 1 in 40 adults are suffering from these diseases. I am working in Ispahani Islami Eye Institute Hospital in Bangladesh, which is one of the oldest and largest eye care specialty hospital in our country. And there was a study in 2018 to 2019. We have seen nearly 280,000 patients in last year. And out of those patients, 23,000 patients was glaucoma patient. And out of the glaucoma patient, angle closure was more, which was nearly 43%, but open angle glaucoma was nearly 25%. So in our country, angle closure is more common than primary open angle glaucoma. You know, trabeculectomy is the still now gold standard glaucoma filtration surgery, and its success rate up to 100% in experienced hand. But for this, you need to modify its technique. You need to use different types of anti-metabolites during the surgical procedure, and you have to use releasable scissor. Then you will get a successful trabeculectomy. All you know, trabeculectomy is a very simple surgery. Just you need to make a hole. But be very careful. Don't fall into that hole, because it has lots of devastating complications. First thing is anesthesia. There are different types of anesthesia you are using in trabeculectomy. We are commonly using perivalvar anesthesia. You know, it will give a good anesthesia, but it has few complications. You can also use subtenons anesthesia during trabeculectomy, and it also gives good anesthesia, and it has less complication than perivalvar anesthesia. You can also topical anesthesia, but patient may feel few pain or discomfort during the procedure. But problem is that if patient vision is normal but very advanced glaucoma, poor visual threshold, or only central island of vision, then what types of anesthesia you are prefer? Mostly I prefer subtenous anesthesia in advanced glaucoma, because white power syndrome or post-surgical vision loss is less common in subtenous anesthesia than perivalvar anesthesia. It is a very simple technique by which
video not
That's why I want to use my laptop. Can I use my laptop? Yeah, I have laptop here. Yeah. By very simple way, you can give the subtenous anesthesia job. Just you need to dissect conjunctiva, then using a blunt gel cannula, you can inject it subtenous space. So it is very simple technique, and by this way, you can do trabeculectomy in a better way. Next important thing is the antifibrotic. There are different types of antifibrotic we are using. The most commonly antifibrotic is mitomycin C that we are commonly practicing. Another neuronin collagen or collagen matrix that we are using. But the question is, which one is comparatively better and which one is more effective? You know, the mitomycin C has lots of bleb related complications than collagen matrix. I had a study by comparing the mitomycin C with collagen, which one is more effective in trabeculectomy and safer. That was published in European Journal of Ophthalmology. And there I found both are effective, but collagen is much more safer than mitomycin C because mitomycin C has lots of bleb related complication like thin bleb, cystic bleb, or late bleb leakage may be happened. So we can easily apply antifibrotic. Mitomycin C you can inject subconjunctivally, or after the conjunctival dissection you can implant it. But in case of collagen, after all the procedure is just placed in subconjunctival. The next important thing is the making the conjunctival flap. You know, you can make it in Fornix based or Limbus based. Both are effective, but technically Limbus based, it may hamper your further procedure and it may produce subconjunctival scar behind the scleral flap. That's why I personally prefer Fornix based flap in trabeculectomy. The next important thing is how to make a scleral flap. You can make it triangular or rectangular. Both are effective, but I personally prefer triangular flap because technically it is easier and less time consuming, and you can make it close by only single stitch after the procedure. This video showing the procedure of making scleral flap in single trabeculectomy. Though I prefer triangular flap, just I am making scleral flap in trabeculectomy. This is the procedure of making triangular flap in combined surgery in TAB SICS. Just same things, but you need to extend it at the level of limbus to the periphery so that you can easily deliver the lens at the same port. And you can make also close this flap only single stitch, no need to give multiple stitch. This is the procedure of making flap in trap phaco. After making triangular flap in the same manner, then I always use two separate four for phaco emulsification. After making scleral flap, now I am doing phaco emulsification by separate port. Now you can make ostium by punch forceps or 15 degree knife. Personally, I prefer to use punch forceps because it is easy to handle, and you can make enlarge your ostium by seeing you what you need. Now most important thing is level of closure. At the level of closure, You can use both fixed suture or releasable suture. Some surgeons prefer only fixed suture, some surgeons prefer both. I personally prefer both types of suture in trabeculectomy. When I will do single trabeculectomy, then I only prefer one fixed suture at the apex of the triangular flap, then two releasable suture at the two sides. First time I applied fixed suture, now I am giving releasable suture. It is very easy to why to give. First needle pass through the under the conjunctiva into the cornea, then make a loop at the limbus, then four knot is applied at the site of the incision mark. Now at the in same manner I am applying another releasable suture at the other side of the incision. But in case of combined procedure, I always give single stitch, and if I need to apply more stitch, then I give releasable suture. But in case of phacoemulsification, I applied another stitch at the phacocyte port. So this is few post-op picture after trabeculectomy. You see releasable suture. So this type of releasable suture you can easily remove in postoperative period on outpatient department, but only seeing in slit lamp examination. So if you need proper filtration, then you need to make a good bleb. And when a patient is diffuse, mildly vascularized, elevated bleb, then you can see your IOP is maintaining and patient is in good control of intraocular pressure. In case of primary angle closure glaucoma, I prefer always early surgery, because if you do early surgery is primary angle closure glaucoma, either it combined surgery or either phacoemulsification, then you will get always good control of intraocular pressure in postoperative period. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, sir. Many practical tips for glaucoma surgeons to make their trab more effective. Dr. J.C. Das is in the house. I would like his opinion on the same. Do we have a floating mic? Mike.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Excellent slides, excellent surgery. But I'd like to give certain comments in this sense that trabeculectomy or any other surgery in glaucoma is personalized. You must practice the surgery and the steps which is best suited to your hand. For so many years, maybe I have modified my technique not less than 20, 25 times, trying all the procedures under the sun. And still I'm looking for an ideal surgery in my hand to suit all the patients. So that way one has to really find out what type of suturing has to do, what type of flap, and how much to tighten it, whether to put a releasable suture or not. And nowadays we have suture for not a releasable suture, it's an adjustable suture. Adjustable sutures. So that is very, very personalized. But the basic principles, the least cautery, least damage to the subendoral space, least dissection, and the best results. And how much application of mitomycin C in whichever area you plan has to be really personalized depending on the case you deal and the best result you get in your hand. Right? But excellent video, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So, Dr. Bipul, I have a few questions. Do you titrate the time of MMC application, or do you use it, for the same period in all the patients?
Sorry?
Do you titrate the amount or the time of MMC? Like, do you use it for 2 minutes, 3 minutes patients?
Yeah.
Or do you change it according to the baseline IOP?
Of course. You need to, in case of mitomycin C, you need to apply its 2 minute average, 2 to 3 minutes, or 1.5 minutes, it depends. Some cases that are refractory to our silent surgery, then you need to apply more time.
For, yeah. And what about ALS? Do you use a laser suture lysis in your clinic?
No, though there is option of suture lysis, but if you apply releasable suture, then you can easily remove.
Yeah.
And only one suture will be there.
Right.
But in case of combined surgery, I personally give one single fixed suture.
Fixed suture.
So, no
yeah.
need to remove
so you
that.
Don't need to remove it ever. Yeah. Okay, and when do you release your releasable suture?
It depends upon the cases. So you need to see that in post-operative period, you see in after 3 days or first day or 3 days or 7 days, there is a shallow anterior chamber, but AC stable, then you can keep the suture. But if you see that there is a stable AC, everything is good, then you can release one suture. And another stitch you can remove after 1 week.
Right.
Usually I prefer to remove stitch within the 2 weeks or 3 weeks.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Do we have any question here?
Dr. Sarkar, how is experience about using 5-FU post-operatively and using intraop MMC? Which one do you find better?
Post-operatively, I prefer 5-FU, but intraoperative.
No, I am asking that which one is better, whether using intraop MMC or post-op 5-FU?
Personally, ma'am, I don't prefer to use 5-FU. I personally use MMC or allogen implant. Allogen is little bit costly, but I found sometimes it better result than MMC because it can maintain a space within the sclera within subconjunctival space, so there are less chance of fibrosis. I have a lot of patient after allogen application, they are still now very good control of intraocular pressure. But personally, I don't have any experience in using 5-FU.
But what I feel, 5-FU can be used, yeah. But in MMC intraop, when we use, there are more chances of having a bleb leak as compared to post-op. If you are applying, like if you are doing a case of like moderate glaucoma, combined surgery we have done, and we are not going for an intraop MMC. That's my personal experience. So I preserve MMC. I don't use MMC in that particular case. And I later on I titrate with 5-FUs, and that is
what
giving.
My experience is in combined surgery. One has to use MITRE because the chances of failure of combined surgery is much more than simple trabeculectomy.
Yeah.
You may decide not to use mitomycin C in simple trabeculectomy if you are doing a primary surgery and in a moderate. But in very advanced glaucoma, since you need pressures in early teens or in single digit, I think it is always a better idea to use mitomycin C. Uh-huh. Although what my technique is that now, like my goal is to facilitate the posterior flow. So I don't cut the scleral flap right up to the limbus.
Yes.
I just leave little bit of flap unopened on both the sides of limbus and releasable suture mostly at the apex. Or I make scleral, So I think that way you can facilitate the posterior flow and
the ring of steel can be
rings of steel and
yes.
So.
Can I have little bit of my comments on the adjustable sutures or even releasable sutures? Let us understand why do you put a releasable suture. Releasable sutures are of particular value when the intraocular pressure immediate postoperative is likely to be high, or you intentionally see that the pressure is not low. Say for example, a vitrectomized eye, for example, high myopes, ophthalmic eyes, or even non-ophthalmic eyes, where you expect the intraocular pressure in the immediate posterior period, if it goes low, it will land with a lot of complications of supracoroidal hemorrhage, supracoroidal effusion, and complications of maculopathy and all that. So for first 1 or 2 weeks, you want that the pressure should not be very low. That's why you have passed more number of sutures on the table and see that intentionally the pressure remains slightly on the high side. The moment you see that the wound healing is complete or it is reasonably so, you release it in 2 weeks' time. After 2 weeks, releasable suture has no role because it is already adhered. So but most of the cases you have titrated the wound on the table, I think you don't need any releasable suture. So if you release the releasable sutures early, so nothing happens, but after 2 weeks, even if you pull it with the adjustable suture, the flap is not going to be reflected. So practically, that doesn't have any value, provided you have I titrated it on the tip quite well, and the chamber is well formed, and the pressure is within the within your acceptable limit, maybe 8 to 10. I think relative sutures are a very, very limited value, except that in cases of high myopes, in vitrectomized eyes, in non-ophthalmic eyes, where you need the pressure, immediate post of the pressure should not be low.
Right, sir. So we had great discussion. Thank you so much, Dr. Bipul. Let's start with the IC. So glaucoma at crossroads, I request our my co-instructors, Dr. Sunita, Dr. Shweta, Dr. Monica, and Dr. Manish, to kindly come on stage. No? You want to stay there? Okay. Okay, right. So with today's evolving understanding of the mechanics of glaucoma, we are often caught up in credibility of our diagnostic tools about when and how to intervene. The biggest challenge remains in prompt and accurate decision making, and today we intend to help you achieve that, at least to a certain extent. So my first co-instructor is Dr. Manish. He has completed his post-graduation from KGMC Lucknow and glaucoma fellowship at Shankar Netralay Chennai, where he joined as a consultant till 2015. He's currently heading the glaucoma department at Ratan Jyoti Netralaya, Gwalior. My journey in glaucoma started courtesy him because he was the one who assisted my first trab. So he'll be talking today in the lines of the controversial Eagle study, whether it's a revolution or an over-treatment.
Thank you for the introduction. So I'll be talking about a controversy around the lens extraction for angle closure and how justified it is. Now, why lens is implicated is because we know that after cataract surgery, a narrower phakic angle converts to a wider pseudophakic angle. We are knowing that the lens is around 4 to 5 millimeters, and we are changing it with a plastic lens, and therefore there is a wider angle. The trabecular meshwork also widens by increasing the mechanical tension on the zonules, and that decreases the resistance to the outflow, causing a reduction of intraocular pressure. Even if we talk about open angle glaucoma, and the angles are open or even ocular hypertensives, there is an increased outflow because of the widened trabecular meshwork. But it is not a substantial reduction of intraocular pressure, maybe around 2 to 3 millimeters of mercury. It correlates to a preoperative intraocular pressure, so it's very high, it might reduce much more, but sometimes it could be very, very transient and the pressures may rise again after some period of time. However, if we look at angle closure, there are two mechanisms. One is a relative pupillary block, which might finally result in synechias or adhesions causing a raised intraocular pressure. The second one is an angle crowding, which can may have an anterior placement of lens due to increased thickness of the lens or displacement of the lens. So these two mechanisms will be responsible for the raised pressures and angle closure, and that's what we are focusing in this talk. Now, what are the controversial points in this? Now, we're talking about lens extraction as a treatment part, and second, the controversy is about a clear lens extraction and what it implicates to an angle closure disease. That's all the part of the discussion. If you define angle closure, it could be primary angle closure suspect, it could be primary angle closure or primary angle closure glaucoma. That's how we classify angle closure. Now, how would we find out the effectiveness of any sort of surgery or disease is because of effect of the surgery on the intraocular pressure per se, what happens to the angles, and secondarily, what happens to the number of medications a person is using after the surgery is done. Briefly, if we classify angle closure disease, it's angle closure suspect when the intraocular pressures are normal, everything appears to be okay, the disc is normal, there are no synechias, or a primary angle closure in which the IOP or there is a presence of peripheral anterior synechias, or an angle closure glaucoma where we find an obvious disc damage. All these three conditions would have a certain amount of closure of the angle associated with each of them in dim illumination. Now, first of all, we'll come to angle closure suspect. Now, there are two conditions. Either there is a clear lens or a cataractous lens. But in a clear lens, we know that there are potential complications of surgery. We'll also have loss of accommodation. And therefore, we go for preferably a laser iridotomy in selected cases. The lens is cataractous. Go ahead with a cataract surgery in a PACS. So there's no too much of controversy in an angle closure suspect. Lens is cataractous, angle closure suspect, disc is normal, pressures are normal. There is a cataract, go for cataract surgery. There is no cataract, and you find that possibly this person has a substantial risk of developing glaucoma. There may be a family history, there may be some retinal issues, or there may be very patchy pigmentation of the angle. So at those certain selected cases, you can decide for a laser iridotomy. So what are the controversial points? Should we go for a clear lens extraction? And what happens to the rest of the two, the primary angle closure and the primary angle closure glaucoma? The PACS has already been dealt with. Now what most people actually tell you, that if whatever we are doing for a lens with a cataract, can't we do the same thing for a clear lens? Because basically we are removing the lens in both the situations. So probably the angle behaves in a very similar way. It's just the cataract. And they're trying to implicate this condition to a clear lens. So we're trying to confuse the two of them together. Now I come to one of the studies. This is published in the Indian context. And you can see three graphs there. And you can see the primary angle closure, suspect primary angle closure, and the primary angle closure glaucoma. And over a period of time, you'll see that following a cataract surgery alone, you find a drop in all of these three, and this was sustained over a period of time, over a period of around a year. If you look at the number of anti-glaucoma medications that we see on the other side, we find that there is a decrease in anti-glaucoma medications. If you look at the top of the graph, the yellow line, you'd see that that one is the medically uncontrolled glaucomas. So these pressures were not under very good control, but they underwent a cataract surgery, and there was a certain amount of reduction of pressure even in that situation. However, if you look closely into the picture, even for advanced POAGs, PSEG, sorry, the intraocular pressure was in the range of around 17 plus minus 5 millimeters of mercury. And the patients were also given a choice. In patients with PSEG where IOP is not well controlled, were given a choice of undergoing a cataract surgery alone or a combined phacoemulsification with trabeculectomy, with the understanding that the glaucoma surgery could be done later on. And data for patients who consented for cataract surgery alone were analyzed. So probably some of these patients might not have been ready to undergo only a cataract surgery at this point. The second point was that all patients with pre-existing glaucoma, except the laser iridotomy, were excluded. So patients who had undergone a laser iridotomy were on medications, and they were taken up for surgery only if they consented for a certain part. Now I'll come to the second part, that is the Eagle. Now this is trying to change the practice that we are planning to do, or we are planning to move forwards. Now, briefly about this trial, the minimum age was around 50 years, and patients with primary angle closure with pressures more than 30 millimeters of mercury or above, or angle closure glaucoma with pressures more than 21 millimeters of mercury, were taken for the study. It's very important that they excluded advanced glaucomas. The glaucomas advanced would include a mean deviation more than 15 decibels. We probably have much more complex patients than what they had, or a CD ratio of more than 0.9, or even a prior laser. Now, these patients were randomized either to a clear lens extraction or a standard care, including PI or medications. Very, very important is that a lot of gonioscopic data, even in this sort of trial, has been missing, and they have put up into the paper. So even for a trial in which you're trying to look for angle closure, we are not finding the gonioscopic data which should have been there. Look at the results. They did find that with a clear lens extraction, the number of medications required over a period of time and additional glaucoma surgery also was much less as compared to the iridotomy group. However, if you look into the visual fields, you find that they were fairly stable in both the groups. Now, as per the results of the study, they say that considering this approach as a first-line treatment, so this was a clear lens extraction for individuals with primary angle closure disease, so that they consider this clear lens as to be as a treatment part, this is not for an angle closure disease. They conclude that the results indicate that a clear lens extraction should be considered as an initial treatment for primary angle closure glaucoma and primary angle closure with increased intraocular pressure. Now, there are certain caveats in any study, but that's what this Eagle trial concluded. Even the consensus series by the World Glaucoma Association put up that in patients with coexisting cataract and angle closure, lens extraction is an effective intervention and associated with substantial reduction of IOP. We do agree with that, that even for an angle closure disease and you do a cataract surgery, definitely there will be a certain improvement of pressures over a period of time. And they put up the same part that clear lens extraction can be considered for certain patients that were included in the Eagle trial. What are the drawbacks when we look at it very, very closely? What happens if there is an angle, primary angle closure in which pressures are less than 30 millimeters of mercury? And what happens to advanced PACGs? Now we find a number of our patients to be in that age group, and that has been excluded from the trial. What happens to complications for surgery in case we are trying to do especially for a clear lens? and what happens to loss of accommodation also especially important for a clear lens. So there are certain caveats that we need to look into. Now there are two ways that we can look into this. One is to look from a glaucoma surgeon's perspective. The other one is to look from a cataract surgeon's perspective. So if you look from a cataract surgeon's perspective and his approach to angle closure, we'd find that most clinicians rely on gonioscopy on the right side to assess angle closure, and this evaluation takes a great skill to perform and is highly subjective. So they are thinking on a different line than what we would like them to think. They would also say that cataract surgery performed following trabeculectomy is technically more difficult. You have some reasons to carry more risk. There may be hypotony, there may be infection, and glaucoma surgery in pseudophakic eye would be more preferable, and even removing mild cataracts may be the best intervention. So know that their thinking line is very different. They want to push something from a cataract surgeon's perspective over a glaucoma surgeon's perspective. Gonioscopy is not that difficult. It is easier than doing a cataract surgery. If you look at disease estimates of angle closure, we'd find a large number of people who are affected. Primary angle closure disease would be around 27 million. The population of Delhi would be around 25 million. And the PAC and PACG would be around 6.6 million. Plus, we find a number of our patients who actually come up with this sort of situation. They undergo a cataract surgery and we find out that the glaucoma has been missed following a cataract surgery. So we are missing on the diagnosis also. The millions who are waiting for cataract surgery at this point, and especially in developing countries where manual SICS with a conjunctival incision is a most commonly performed mode of lens removal, this would give a wrong prejudice to say that a cataract surgery alone may be treating glaucoma for us. There is an insufficient evidence to suggest a clear lens extraction as a treatment of choice in angle closure, and I'd like to go against what the EAGLE study has told us. And I would conclude by saying that initial standard practice patterns in PACG and PAC should be followed, including the PI and medications and surgery as per the current guidelines. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Lots of points to ponder upon. Again, it's not just about deepening the angle. There are a lot of things to consider. Do we have questions from the house? No, in that case, thank you, sir. We'll move on to the next talk. So there are a few people in your life who act as a constant guide in your professional trajectory. You want to be them, you look up to them, and Dr. Sunita is one of such a person. She is my go-to person. She heads the glaucoma department at Shroff Charity Eye Hospital, Delhi. She's also the chairperson of the quality assurance there. She did her fellowship at Wills Eye Hospital, Philadelphia in 2002 and has more than 100 publications and book chapters to her credit.
Ma'am. Thank you, Richa, for having me here in your IC. So RNFL thinning on OCT, does it always warrant treatment? I think it's a very debatable question. As we know, glaucoma is a progressive disease with characteristic optic neuropathy and visual field loss. However, the current evidence suggests that the structural loss precedes functional loss, and in the old study, disc changes were detected much earlier than the visual field abnormalities in over half of the patients who progressed to the initial diagnosis of glaucoma. As we know, we are often diagnosing glaucoma and treating here when there is already a 50% loss of retinal ganglion cell or there is a visual function loss. So it's very important to catch the subtle structural changes early in the course of the disease so as to prevent the blindness because of this disease. As we know, clinical evaluation of optic nerve head and RNFL remain the gold standard till today also for diagnosis of glaucoma, and so the stereophotography. However, it's a very subjective test and is subjected to a lot of inter-observer variability. So imaging, with the advent of imaging technologies which provide more objective and reproducible assessment of ONH and RNFL, they are increasingly utilized over the last couple of years. The OCT now is a tool of choice because of its wide applicability and has undergone major advancements from time domain to spectral domain and now the swept source OCT.
and with definite advantages of spectral domain OCT, that there's a very good axial resolution, faster speeds, 3D images, reproducibility, and advanced segmentation algorithms wherein we can see all the layers of the retina very clearly, very good accuracy, and increased progression detection. And we do have the evidence for pre-perimetric glaucoma, wherein in our clinical practice, wherein we see the optic nerve and RNFL changes, and there are no visual field changes. Like this patient, there are definitely RNFL changes and OCT also, and disc changes, but there are no visual field changes. So there are signs of pre-perimetric glaucoma, and therefore RNFL assessment has emerged as an important parameter in the diagnosis of pre-perimetric glaucoma before it appears on the perimetry. And there is very good ROC curves for differentiation between early and pre-perimetric glaucoma in mild early cases and on OCT, so which suggests that OCT has a very good diagnostic capability. There's a growing evidence that early glaucomatous changes involve macula, since macula has the highest density of ganglion cells. And as we understand, the inferior zone of macula, which projects RNFL fibers to the inferior pole of the disc, is the most vulnerable area, which can now be seen on OCT. And it correlates very well with the visual field analysis. As we see, this is the most vulnerable zone, and this zone, which is the resistant zone, is seen as the central island of preserved field in your visual field analysis. And it correlates well with the RNFL analysis as well. And as I said, with advanced segmentation algorithm, we are able now to delineate various layers of OCT in macular scan. So you can also get this temporal RAFI sign on OCT, and it is because of the asymmetrical damage of glaucoma, which happens on either side of the horizontal RAFI, and it is a useful tool for discrimination of glaucoma from non-glaucomatous optic atrophy. As we know, glaucoma respects horizontal meridian, and you can see it very well this here. And this is one of our patients, patient who had normal intraocular pressure, and you can see here that this is RNFL defect here, inferotemporally, which is seen here as a visual field defect. And you can see this horizontal RAFI in the macular OCT. So you can correlate all these points and come to a conclusion. OCT is very, very good in detecting progression also on both RTView as well as Cirrus OCT, and you can see both as both trend analysis and event-based analysis. You can see this expansion of the defect here, and here also the deepening of defect, more of black and more of red as the significance map, and this is new damage inferiorly. So you can detect progression also on OCT. Now the new thing is this Forum software, where you can correlate your combined structural and functional damage. So basically this was developed by Hood et al. By creating a map with six zones by aligning the center of the 24 dash field to the fovea, and a circle of approximately 6 millimeter, which is the size of an average optic nerve head, was generated, and two images were digitally aligned. So you get one report, the combined report, which includes both OCT and field analysis, and the OCT displays flipped along the horizontal axis so that it corresponds with the visual field data. So the inferior OCT, which corresponds to the superior visual field region, is superimposed like this. And you do see good correlation of structure and function in your clinical practice as well. This was one of our patients who is showing good correlation. You can see this CT ratio 0.7 and 0.8. In the right eye, there are hardly any visual field changes, but there are pre-perimetric RNFL changes. And in the left eye, it is seen as a superior defect with inferior RNFL change, which is superimposed here on the visual field change. And this is more advanced, and this is pre-perimetric. As you can see, the visual fields are normal. The patient has 0.6 and 0.7
cupping with inferior loss, and which is depicted as a superior visual field loss with the superimposition of RNFL here. So there is a good correlation. However, these two structure and function changes do not always correlate. There are certain caveats. The false negative and the false positive, the green and red disease, which we are very well aware of. And this patient had a borderline intraocular pressure, and you can see the subtle RNFL defect here, and here this is all green. So this is green disease because still the RNFL thickness was within the normative data of this particular patient. But when you read the OCT carefully, you can see here this is loss of hourglass pattern in the thickness map, and this is this defect inferotemporally, which is correlating with this defect in the deviation map. So you have to read this very, very carefully. Then fallacious OCTs in patients with extensive chorioretinal degeneration and other diseases related to macula. This is a patient with almost normal optic nerve. There were some central defects in the macular area, and when dilated, this patient had this macular scar in the left eye and is showing a lot of changes in the OCT. So this is red disease, and this should not be confused with glaucoma. Again, patient with extensive peripapillary atrophy, as you can see here, a lot of disc changes, and when you do OCT, you'll get a picture like this. Why? Because the calculation circle, this is falling within the limits of peripapillary atrophy, and it's going to give you a wrong reading. So you cannot rely on OCT in such situations, and here you have to rely on the visual fields. Again, OCT is not very, very good in advanced cases. Why? Because there's a floor effect, and RNFL thickness, when it reaches about 40, 50, it bottoms out, and there's no further decrease, even if then the disease is progressing, and it is because of the thickness of the supportive tissue like astrocytes and glial tissue, which also gives some thickness to the RNFL. So one needs to be careful, and it is not recommended to follow up the patient on OCT in very advanced glaucoma. However, OCT is very useful in patients who cannot perform the fields very nicely. There's a lot of learning curve. As you can see here, the patient is not able to perform the fields. And if the OCT is normal, then you are pretty sure, and other parameters are normal, you are pretty sure that the patient is not having glaucoma. So OCT is very good diagnostic strategy for ruling out glaucoma, but it is not good for ruling in glaucoma. So the question whether RNFL thinning always warrant treatment. As we know, lowering intraocular pressure is helpful in all types of glaucomas, and it is helpful in pre-perimetric glaucoma also to prevent the further damage and progression to glaucoma. This is one of the studies which shows that 60% of the pre-perimetric glaucoma, non-treated glaucoma, progressed at 5 years. So it is a good, it is advisable to treat some of these patients who are at high risk. And the factors associated with progression include female sex, cold hands and feet, optic disc hemorrhage, and abnormal baseline FDT perimetry. So these are some of the cases which do require treatment, and so you have to individualize therapy based on these on life expectancy and risk assessments, like myopic patient, positive diurnal variation, family history, disc hemorrhage, and other factors may warrant treatment, like this patient who had borderline intraocular pressure and disc hemorrhage and some optic nerve changes, RNFL thinning here with normal fields, and does require treatment because he has multiple risk factors. However, this patient, where there are OCT changes but there are no associated risk factors, doesn't require treatment. So you have to individualize treatment and just work on principles of 3 R's, that eyes with PPG are likely to be at greater risk of progression. You need to measure the rate of change and reevaluate these eyes to look for any development of any risk factors. However, always remember that rapid progression from pre-perimetric glaucoma to substantial visual loss is the exception and not the rule.
Like it is there, I have rarely seen any rapid progression in patients with pre-perimetric glaucoma unless the other eye is having very advanced glaucoma. So these patients do require a close follow-up and assessment of the risk factor. So to summarize, OCT technology and software algorithms and the recent developments are increasing its utility in our clinical practice and day-to-day management of patients. However, we should be aware of its limitations and possible scan artifacts, and we should not base our decisions based on OCT results only. However, it's a very good complement to a good clinical examination. Thank you.
So, ma'am, in a case of pure dissuspect, when do you call the patient back for a repeat OCT? How often do you do a follow-up here?
Like this suspect, I think you need to see like what kind of this suspect the patient is, whether it is just the enlargement of the cup or there is thinning of the rim, there is notching or disc hemorrhage or thinning of neuroretinal rim. So it depends if the patient is having risk factors, as I said, like if the patient is having a positive family history of glaucoma or patient is diabetic, myopic, or any other risk factor, then you need to follow up the patient more closely, at least 6 monthly, or if the patient is having borderline intraocular pressure also. So you have to follow up the patient more closely.
So six months is enough?
Not having any risk factors and it is just the enlargement of cup and thinning of rim, there is no thinning in particular quadrants, inferior quadrant, or there is no notching or anything, then I think you can just call once a year.
Okay. So, Dr. Manish, you agree with the 6 month protocol, right? And Dr. Das, yeah. So, I was going to ask you, how dependent are you on OCT?
OCT?
Not fully, okay.
Hello, I have a question for ma'am. Yeah. Actually, in some OCT, I saw there is a superior red region, but no inferior red region.
And there is superior?
Superior red.
Rim changes.
And no inferior, and patient is pseudophakic. So, what to do in such cases? Even I repeated the OCT.
You can have superior rim thinning or inferior rim thinning. Uh-huh. Although inferior is more common superior is also common because there are changes. These fibers are thick fibers and the lamina cribrosa pores are more there. And so I think that makes superior and inferior nerve fiber, arcuate fibers more susceptible to damage. Although inferior fibers are more susceptible because of the crowding of fibers also, because a lot of fibers are going to the inferior pole
so
of the
may
disc.
Occur,
but it is not necessary that you will always get inferior. You can get superior rim thinning
and,
also.
Another question is that in OCT we should repeat 1 yearly as classically says. 1 yearly OCT RNFL?
See, it all depends on the severe. You are talking about pre-perimetric or otherwise?
No, otherwise.
Otherwise, it depends if the patient is having moderate to severe glaucoma. Severe glaucoma, it is not useful, as I said. Then you should follow up on fields. But if the patient is having moderate glaucoma
progression.
Yeah, but mostly it is used for early and pre-perimetric glaucoma, because in moderate glaucoma patient will have field changes also, so it is better to follow up on fields rather than on OCT. But for early and pre-perimetric glaucoma, till the patient gets definitive field changes, you can follow up on OCT.
Right, thank you, ma'am.
What I was telling was no way that you start the treatment on the basis of OCT, very clear, right? So because you repeat the same OCT after 15 minutes, that is change in your results. So one recording of OCT is not the final treatment, final modalities for the treatment. So you have to be really do it more frequently and see whether there is any actual damage, then you might think of. Now the tendency in American society is to start the treatment for the pre-perimetric glaucomas. And they don't depend on the visual field anymore, they depend on the pre-perimetric changes. But that may not stand correct in our setup. But one word of caution is, when we are not putting the patient on treatment, be aware of the medico-legal aspect. Patients have become very medico-legally conscious, they might drag to court, here is the OCT report and this is showing some change, why didn't you start the treatment, why did you wait for the change to regress or change to get advanced? So that then you have become little more offensive, you cannot do that. So you have to be very careful when you are not putting the patient on treatment. So that is, you know, putting the treatment is easy, but with the, at the cost. The patient has to be, patient's quality of life suffers, his financial applications, his follow-up and everything together is difficult. But even then, if you want to be on the safe side, be very, very careful. I'm not telling that you start the treatment for it, for any, but be very, very analytical. Keep the records ready for future complications for the medical purposes, medical purposes.
So I was going to ask a similar question. You have a red disease on OCT. You've given the report to the patient. How do you explain to the patient that even if this report is showing changes, you do not require treatment?
No, as I had shown, red disease is because of several factors. The patient is myopic, extensive peripapillary degeneration, large disc, okay, or any other pathology. Yeah. So you can have red disease, and this is basically the false negative.
So how do you explain to the patient?
Yeah. So this is false positive, and you have to explain to the patient that it could be because of some other
causes you are having
glasses power or whatever.
Right,
so
right.
You have to explain, and patient should always be made partner in the management. Yeah. As sir was saying, if patient has risk factors, and if the patient warrants treatment, then you have to tell the patient. And if the patient wants to wait just to see progression, because sometimes the progression is very, very slow.
Slow, yeah.
And then the life expectancy and like management is completely different. Diagnosis is different, but whether you decide to manage that patient,
not, yeah.
I think that's a different game altogether.
Yes. This is really very, very important to explain the patient and its relative.
Yeah.
And explain that this red thing chart is not because of something else. Don't get worried about the red part of it. And the patients, the relatives have to be more convinced about it. So, and put it on record that they have been explained very clearly with the chart in front of them. This is very important actually.
Ma'am, I have a question. Out of two parameters, RNFL and GCC, which one you rely more on? Like sometimes RNFL is absolutely normal and we have a small papillary areas of redness in GCC. So how do you follow up and which one you rely on?
See, RNFL is time tested. GCC now is a new parameter, but now is being extensively studied, and I have shown the diagrams that the macular area which is vulnerable to damage, and it is the ganglion cell which are lost early. So a lot of focus and attention is being paid now on the ganglion cell thickness also. And now it is correlating very well with the visual field changes and as well as the RNFL changes also, as I had shown. So, but I would say that you can't treat patient on the basis of any printout. You have to treat the patient as a whole, taking into consideration all other clinical parameters and risk factors. So you're not treating OCT, you're treating the patient.
So we need to follow up the patient. Yeah, if RNFL is normal and GCC has some change.
Yeah.
So I'm actually deviating a little bit from the topic. What is your take on OCT angiography, ma'am?
OCT angiography is still not established for glaucoma because it is basically measuring the capillary perfusion around the disc, and there are so many comorbid conditions which can lead to decreased perfusion, like diabetes, hypertension. So actually, like I don't think right now it is good for measurement for diagnosis of glaucoma.
And it's not established actually whether it's the cause or the effect of glaucoma.
What
it could be because of the glaucoma.
Yeah. So whether it is the cause or the effect,
Whether
the decreased perfusion is causing glaucoma or glaucoma is causing
decay. It's caused by the
decrease. So we are not very.
Do we have any more questions? So we'll move on with the next. So we have our next speaker, Dr. Monica. Thank you, ma'am. She's an alumnus of MAMC GNEC. She underwent her glaucoma training under Professor N.N. Sood and is currently working as Associate Medical Director at Shroff Charity Eye Hospital. She will be talking on unreliable fields. What should be done? Should we just discard it without giving it a second glance, or does it give you an insight into the disease?
Yeah, Thank you, Richa, for having me here, and good morning to all of you. So visual fields still remain as the important cornerstone of management of glaucoma. So whether they are reliable or not is a very important thing, and we need to look at this the reliability indices very carefully. To understand them, we have three reliability indices: the fixation losses, false positive, and false negative. To understand them a little better, it is necessary that we understand how the field machine acts and how the test is conducted. So to begin with, the patient looks at the four dots, and the foveal threshold is measured, and along with it, therefore, the blind spot is also being mapped out. After that, the patient starts looking at the central dot, and the various stimulus of different intensity are projected in the bowl of the machine. So if suppose the patient is not looking at the central dot but is moving the eye towards the stimulus, there will be fixation loss. But how the fixation loss is calculated by the machine is the number of times that the patient responds to a stimulus which was presented on the presumed blind spot divided by the total number of such presentations. So that means that if the patient is not looking at the center and a stimulus is projected at the blind spot and the patient presses, that means that there is a fixation loss. And this is said that, okay, up till 20% of fixation losses we can accept. But let's see how it actually works in the practical scenario. So if we take a look at this printout, we can see that there are 16 out of 18 times that the patient was shown a stimulus at the blind spot, the patient responded. Now this is significantly a high number. Now what should be done for this patient? So this is definitely an unreliable field, and you have to explain to the patient that you have to look at the central spot and not look towards the stimulus. And once you explain it clearly, the patient gives you a very wonderful result. But let's take another thing that we have with the newer machines is that while the patient is doing the test, you can hover your cursor over onto the spot which is being tested or has been tested, and you can see where the patient was looking. And with your forum, you can actually do it later on also. So you are looking at the fields and you say, okay, this patient had a lot of fixation losses, I want to see what happened. You can hover around the various points and you can find out whether the patient was actually looking straight or not. So taking another example, now this was another patient, a 47-year-old patient, and the fixation losses were 3 out of 15, and there was a double cross marked for this. And also the patient had excessive high false positives in addition to the fixation losses. And well, it was written on the printout that the perimetrist has tried it twice, the patient doesn't want to do it again, probably is tired. So the perimetrist had given up on the patient. But surprising thing is that right after doing this right eye, the patient underwent the left eye quite comfortably. So it was thought that the patient was tired. There was something else going on. So the fixation losses also told us something, and there is something else which is very remarkable over here is the foveal threshold. So looking at that and dilating the pupil, you can see that there is a macular pathology because of which the patient is not able to fixate onto the central target. So if you can, if you do want a field to be done in this case, you can ask the patient to look at the diamond, the small diamond or the large diamond, and you can get a better reliable field result. So the causes of fixation losses, we have to remember it, because one, it could be that your presumed location of the blind spot is incorrect, or the nasal field of the other eye is not properly occluded, so the patient is actually seeing from the other eye, or simply that the patient is trigger happy, or there is a head tilt, or there is a macular pathology. Now going over to the false positives. Now the definition of false positive is the number of times the patient responds when there is no stimulus shown, and divided by the total number of times when a machine is paused without presenting a stimulus. The acceptable range would be 15%, although 33 is also, you know, said in a number of books. So false positive in SITA strategies, actually there are no explicit false positive catch trials. It is just responses which are at unexpected times that are captured. and the patient is labeled as a trigger happy patient. Now, false positives can bring about a lot of changes in your field report. So one, it will obviously show you the false positive with the double cross. Now, because the patient is trigger happy, he will press the buzzer even when the stimulus is on the blind spot, so therefore you will have a fixation loss. There will be stimulus which are very dim, yet the patient sees, therefore the grayscale is going to be quite white because low stimulus, low intensity stimulus are also being picked up. The excessive high false positive will be flagged out. GHT will obviously be outside normal limits. And an interesting thing is that you will find that there are changes in the pattern deviation plot and hardly any changes in the total plot. This again is another indicator that the patient has a lot of false positives. The MD becomes a positive number. So all of these changes come in because the patient has been trigger happy. So this becomes an unreliable field and you need to repeat that. But let's take another look at an unreliable field which has been flagged out as false positives. Here you can see that the points of decreased retinal sensitivity both in the total and the pattern deviation plot. Now the next thing that you would go before discarding this field is look at the clinical picture. Well, does it not fit? There is some amount of apparent retinal thinning because it's a tilted and a torted disc and there is peripapillary atrophy, but does this correspond to the visual field? It does not seem so. So you have to look at the other characteristics that, okay, fine that the Anderson's criteria is being met, but is this a reproducible field? And the clues that you're getting are from your reliability indices, the refractive error, and the clinical picture. So once you repeat the field after explaining, you would get something which is more clinically correlatable and therefore something that you can use as a follow-up, as a baseline for future follow-up. Now coming on to the last the false negatives. So false negative is when the patient has been shown a stimulus at a particular point and the machine goes back with a brighter stimulus. Now obviously if the patient has responded to a less intense stimulus, then the brighter stimulus should be seen, but the patient does not press the buzzer. So this is the number of times a patient fails to respond to a presumably visible stimulus divided by total number of such presentations and the acceptable limit being 20%. So this is what the patient sees, the stimulus and presses the buzzer. A brighter stimulus is shown and the patient does not press the buzzer. Now this could happen, one, if the patient has inconsistent responses or the patient has changed his criteria during the time of the test, or there's a change in the state of alertness, or sometimes they feel that, okay, it's too late to respond, let me not press the buzzer. But it also happens in an advanced stage of glaucoma because visibility is variable at the abnormal locations. So if we take a look at this field, now this has a high degree of false negative errors, 46%, and there is a characteristic clover leaf pattern. Now this happens because at the four cardinal points, initially when the patient was alert, the buzzer was being pressed. But as the state of alertness goes on decreasing, the peripheral points are not being responded to. So this becomes an unreliable field. But if we look at these fields where the false negatives have been blocked out as NA and there is no pattern deviation possible, and you look at the clinical picture, you see that the patient has advanced disease and therefore this is the picture. So here, all of the false negatives, NA, actually tell you this was not the right choice of the fields. One should have gone ahead with a 10-2 and got a better baseline for the patient's management. Now this is another field wherein we have presumably reliable indices. The fixation losses, false positive, false negatives are normal. Is this a reliable field? Yes, by definition it is a reliable field, but do we take this field as our management field? We look at the picture of the clinical picture and what we can see is that it is a vertically oval disc with some thinning in the superior rim, some thinning in inferior rim. There is an RNFL defect here, but an even larger RNFL defect inferiorly, which is not being picked up by the visual field. So you have to go ahead and repeat the fields till you get a baseline. So reliability indices will tell you a lot of story, but it is very important to do a clinical correlation and establish a baseline. So to summarize, definitely who's doing the test needs to be alert, has to be, demonstrate the test to the patient before starting, has to make the patient really comfortable, and that is how you can get a reliable field. All fields which are flagged out do not necessarily lack the useful information, so just don't bin them. Look at them, see what has happened, and see whether you can get still extract some information out of them. But definitely the cornerstone is a clinical correlation. Thank you very much.
Well, ma'am, in a fresh case of glaucoma, how many fields do you do to get your baseline field?
See, in a fresh case, I would say definitely the first field should not be taken as the baseline field. You should repeat it, but then more importantly, you should correlate it clinically. If you are getting a good correlation, and because you have to remember that every field means time, okay, your chair time, the patient's time, and it depends upon the policy, whether you are doing repeat fields in the same cost as the first field or you're doing it, you know, for an additional thing. So if you're getting a good correlation, then the first field can also work, but definitely to have a reproducible defect, you should have another.
You need to repeat it. Because of paucity of time, I think we'll go to the next talk. We'll take the, okay. We have time for one question only, sir.
Correctly pointed out that head tilt should not be there during the test. But practically, we find that there are some patients who you simply can't keep their head absolutely perfectly without a tilt. And that worries, you know, whether that is contributing to any of this thing. Practically, does everybody face that problem? Because we have faced it on more than one occasion. Whatever you do, if you put it that way, he says, no, I can't manage. And we have to keep compromise and keep it a little this thing. That's one thing. And second thing, I just wanted to know, as far as unreliable fields are concerned, exactly where is the role of CETA FAST programs in a private practice where supposedly CETA FAST is supposed to be, as a screening tool, it can be used quite freely. But what I have found personally that CETA FAST is not reliable at all. And whatever I looked up to the literature, it suggests that it should be used in only two classes of patients, that is young patients and those who have already experience in perimetry. So from those criteria, in a private practice, then a fresh patient coming, you shouldn't be putting them on CETA FAST. And yet we find so many reports coming in, everybody is doing only CETA FAST and bagging the patient, creating more confusion that this is found and then now what to do, and then I don't find, then what do you tell? And then, like sir said, the medical legal issues everywhere cropping up, So
actually now there is a CETA FASTER also, which has come, which is a 1 minute test, and it is supposed to be a screening test. And we are also actually collecting data to compare the CETA FAST, CETA standard and CETA FASTER to find out if there is a correlation. Definitely these FASTER tests work better if a patient is perimetrically knowledgeable, has done a perimetry before. Having said that, we will have to wait for a little while to see whether the standardization comes through and there is correlation, clinical as well as inter-perimetry correlation between the three tests.
So do I understand right that if it is only for the patient with experience with the perimetry, so suppose a patient has been standardized his, with CETA standard whenever you've been doing, you can switch over then such
that is what
to
that
CETA
is
FAST.
What we are actually studying, that whether if a patient is done on a CETA standard and the next time we do a FAST or a FASTER, is it no sir? we are still collecting the still data onto that.
We are collecting, but it's a good idea to do CETA standard,
but
since you have to repeat fields every 3 to 4 months.
But there's one more. Yes, but there's one more problem with that. When you do it that way, then I found that when you go for the GPA progression analysis and all, then it doesn't accept those
CETA
faster.
No. The newer machines are going to be compatible with that, that you can take
you
either of
keep
these.
On buying your machine.
Yes, true.
Parameter that you have.
Software.
No, we have the GPA software, but it doesn't.
Fine. Thanks a lot. So our next speaker, Dr. Shweta, was my senior at SN and a very dear friend. She is currently working as a senior consultant at Indira Gandhi Eye Hospital and Research Center, Lucknow.
Good morning all, and thank you, Richa, for having me as a part of your instruction course. I'm straight away coming to my assigned topic, that's seeing and having a look over the grip of trabeculectomy in the last 50 years since it has evolved. And actually, calculating properly, it is exactly 52 years. So for this, looking at the 52 years, let's go back in the timeline of 1960s, when the whole world was enjoying the first human being landing on moon in the form of Neil Armstrong. And on the other hand, this gentleman was working gradually, and he revolutionized the field of glaucoma surgery by introducing to us trabeculectomy, the gold standard for surgery as we say now. And he and his colleague at Cambridge Eye Hospital, Dr. Watson, both of them decided to go in a different way. He decided to perform the trabeculectomy by just simply excising the trabecular meshwork, and Dr. Watson did, along with trabecular meshwork, he excised the part of scleral spur also. And this is the result of the first 216 trabeculectomies, and as we can see, the most common complications were there in the form of shallow AC and hyphema ranging from 15% to 16%. And as the era passed by and the decades passed by, the trabeculectomy in 21st century, as quoted by Kervon et al., following the modifications and different techniques, the hyphema and shallow AC, the same complications we are comparing here, and had reduced down much to a lower percentage from 15 to 0.9 and 6%. Again, toward rescue for the glaucoma surgeons and give a pucker result of the glaucoma trabeculectomy surgery, the SAFE surgery system had come in the form of giving the recommendations and guidelines. Like in the first presentation, we were seeing about the dissecting of the cornea and the sclera, that limiting the side incisions only up to the 5 millimeter from the cornea, customization of mitomycin, which suits to need of all each and every individual eye, and the use of adjustable and the releasable sutures for the better titration of IOP. And after following this SAFE surgery system, let's see that Stahlmann et al., what they had to say. They said that less than 21 millimeters of pressure was achieved in 100% of cases, and less than 14 millimeters, that is in the lower teen, we can call it 61.4% cases, had got that much of pressure by just simply following the SAFE trabeculectomy guidelines, with the complications rate falling to much lower percentage, that is ranging up to just 1.8%. So as we all know, the trabeculectomy is a time-tested gold standard for glaucoma surgery, as recommended and supported by several clinical trials and studies. As the CIGTS says, that trabeculectomy has been advised as the first line of treatment modality over laser and medical therapy for advanced glaucoma cases. But then, when we were all enjoying the success of SAFE surgery system by modifying our trabeculectomies, there was again one more change in the field of glaucoma surgery, that was in the form of tubes. And a study said that tubes were recommended beyond refractory glaucoma also. Probably they wanted to say that it could be taken as the first line of choice for some of the cases. And it was seen by a changing trend with a study done by Ramalu et al. In US, which said that yes, there was a likelihood of taking the shunt procedures and the cyclophotocoagulation as the first line of choice as compared to trabeculectomy. Then the 3-year follow-up of TVT came, which said that tube shunt surgeries had a higher success rate as compared to trabeculectomy, but when it was compared with IOP reduction, both had similar kind of IOP reduction with the use of a supplemental medical therapy, though the trabeculectomy group had a more complication rate, which were self-limited and transient also. So the debate continued with the evidence-based medicine suggestion that whenever we are making any surgical decision, the risk profile of the patient's eye, the surgeon's skills and the comfort level of doing that particular surgery, and the patient's willingness to undergo any kind of repeat glaucoma surgery is always warranted and needed. So then, after this, there was a new beginning in the form of offering, we the glaucoma surgeons, offering the patients the concept of customization and early visual recovery in the form of micro-invasive glaucoma surgeries, that's MIGS. The advantages, we all know, that's basically it was a bleb-independent procedure. So the common complications, the uncommon complications of traditional surgery, that is the bleb-related infections, were avoided in this. It could be performed quickly with rapid visual recovery. And just because of the modest efficacy and the favorable safety profile, a patient who was wanting an early transition to surgery can be given an option for this surgery. And also, MIGS may additionally reduce the intolerance and the long-term cost of the medication, and itself it will improve the compliance and the adherence of a glaucoma patient. And we all know that in glaucoma patient, the core concept and the basic thing is to achieve a success is the patient should be compliant and the treatment should be adherent. So now, just looking at the evolution of glaucoma surgeries in the last 25 years, that looking at the percentage reduction caused by the trabeculectomy and going up to the trabectome. As we can see, it is more or less 49.5% in trabeculectomy, and trabectome it is 52%. Yes, we can see that the follow-up period is though less in the MIGS procedure. So in all, we can say due to the limited number of RCTs and lack of standardization, the definition of success, we have yet not come to any consensus and a clear-cut guideline as to offer what kind of mix to what kind of glaucoma patient. So there are many options now in the field of glaucoma surgery, and let's see that what they have to say. Let's start with NPGS, though it is not a very typical of MIGS, but yes, it is a non-penetrating filtering surgery. But the disadvantage is that there is a long learning curve defect in this, and also there is no agreement when it comes to the efficacy as compared to the trabeculectomy. Now coming and straight away starting with the stents, that the 3-year follow-up trial of implantation of 2 stents, because initially the proposed idea was to simply place single stent. Then gradually the studies came and they said no, 2 stents or 3 stents placing had always a upper edge as compared to placing a single stent. Though it said that there was a significant sustained and safe reduction of IOP less than 15 millimeters mercury with a follow-up 36 months, that is 3 years. Again, the stent was compared with the first line of treatment modality for glaucoma cases, that's POAG, that is the PG analog. And again, it said that the percentage reduction in the success was 77% in stent eyes as compared to 53% of a PG analog. Now, this noting this meta-analysis was definitely required when I was given this topic, because trabectome is gaining popularity these days. So let's have a look over this meta-analysis conclusion, which says that there was a 66% of overall success rate at the end of 2 years by performing trabectome as compared to trabeculectomy. And the complication, as we have been talking about since the very beginning of MIGS, was at a much lower rate of serious complications. Now coming back to the stents once again. Again, now when we talk about any surgery, we have to wait with the medical management as well as the laser treatment also. So we have talked about the PG analog. Now let's talk about the selective laser trabeculoplasty. Again, the Hydrus microstent placement was causing a 3-fold greater reduction in the number of medications used in the Hydrus group as compared to the selective laser trabeculoplasty. Then followed this, the game changer came in the form of a Zen gel implant, which gave the edge of and the comfort level to the surgeon of not using a gonioscopy while performing a surgery. And also the surgeon was comfortable because there was no microscope tilting required during the surgery. And there was no conjunctival incision as well. And this was a review of literature which said that there was effective lowering of IOP at the follow-up of 1 year, but with caution, a point to be noted carefully here, that there was a vigilant post-operative follow-up and a frequent post-operative maneuver which was required for all the cases of Zen gel implant and also the in-focus microshunt. And they said that prospective comparative studies were needed in all. So the core concept of glaucoma basically lies against in racing against the time, that is preserving the quality of vision along with the patient's lifetime with the IOP lowering to slow down the progression of the disease as well. So the actual debates, let's have a look in for and against of both the procedures. So when we talk about trabeculectomy, the points goes in favor is being a cheap, effective and acceptably safe procedure, and against would be complications, long follow-ups and results variable in the hand of a single surgeon of the same patient, twice behave in a different way. When we come for MIGS, the advantage is being bleb independent, rapid visual recovery, less post-op manipulations except Zen, but the against points are expensive and the lack of RCTs not giving any clear-cut guidelines as to choose what and when. So the bridging of the gap, both the points, the debate could be concluded with the line quoted by the one of the stalwarts of MIGS, that's Aiki Ahmed, who said that MIGS devices are designed to address the treatment gap that exists between the medical therapy and the most aggressive traditional surgery of glaucoma. So the need of our, in our developing country scenario, something which is affordable and yet technically simple. So I would like to conclude the talk with just a simple slide here, which says that all the surgeries are fundamentally different and each should be offered in different situations for different indications in order to achieve different outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shweta. So angle procedures are not very common in India. Dr. Sunita is doing, she has done the maximum number of cases with trabectomy. So if you're interested, kindly contact. So we'll go to the last talk of this session. So the question we are asking ourselves is that implants in glaucoma, are they overrated? So, as we've already seen, trabeculectomy is celebrating its 52nd year. It is still the gold standard as far as glaucoma surgery is concerned. So what's the need to look for an alternative? It's refractory glaucomas, which do not respond to medical or surgical treatment. And the peculiarities of this involves deranged anatomical configuration, physiology, and dynamics of the aqueous circulation. So the first and foremost thing is to understand why will a trab not work in these conditions. So it does not work when the conjunctiva is scarred and if the inner ostium is likely to close, which happens very frequently in these conditions. Why would an implant work in such situations? It's because the tube goes beyond the angles. We get a Tenon's bleb away from the limbus and the internal tube keeps the ostium open. GDDs can be used as a secondary procedure where GFS has already failed or as a primary surgical modality where it's reported to have a disappointing outcome. So it was designed to divert the aqueous and you would be surprised to know that in 1906 horse hair was the first implant that was used to divert the aqueous from the anterior chamber. Multino in 1969 devised the first GDD and it has undergone many modifications since then. So what does it have? It has a tube, a drainage, a plate, and a valve. So this valve opens and drains the excess fluid out of the eye. So this is how it looks. This is the FP7. What determines a smooth outflow is the same principle which helps aeroplanes and birds to fly. It's the Bernoulli's phenomenon of continuity. So the kinetic energy is inversely proportional to the potential energy. Potential energy depends on the cross-sectional area. So higher the cross-sectional area, the higher will be the potential energy and lower will be the speed. So how does it work? This is the trapezoidal frame of the valve and the increased exit velocity helps to evacuate the fluid with minimal valve friction. So I have this case which was published recently and it's a case of 34-year-old male who had undergone a penetrating keratoplasty, had already undergone trabeculectomy and a cataract surgery and he was one-eyed. The BCVA was 2630 and the intraocular pressure was 40 on maximum therapy. B scan showed complete PVD and OD was absolute. So a one-eyed status, young age with poor IOP control on MMT necessitated an urgent surgical plan. We had two options, either to go with retrab or to go with AJV. So because of these factors, we thought of going ahead with the AJV. So it was planned in superior temporal quadrant with a hybrid 20-25 gauge PPV and placement of tube in the vitreous cavity. So I'll just run the video quickly. This is how the eye looked. This is the corneal traction suture. The conjunctiva is opened. Cautery done. The AJV is primed and is placed in the conjunctival pocket. The plate is sutured to the sclera. And this is the vitrectomy being done. So the lower one is infusion cannula with 20 gauge needle, and the superior ones are 25 gauge cannulas. So complete vitrectomy was done with base excision. And the port suture, the superior ones, the tube was cut, inserted into the vitreous cavity. So the one-day post-op pressure was 10, and the tube was visible in the anterior vitreous cavity. And it was maintained at 4 months as well. So this is another case of a 60-year-old male who was a diabetic. Vision was 2400. High pressures on maximum therapy, and there was florid neovascularization of the iris with 360 degrees sinical closure. So fundus evaluation showed an ischemic CRVO, PRP was done, still the pressure did not come down. So we planned an AJV in with the tube in the sulcus. So this was the only difference, you know, the entry at the sulcus. And the tube, you can see it sitting nicely at the sulcus. The pressure was maintained and the vision improved. So there are other indications, as was mentioned, ICE syndrome and uveitic glaucomas, where it really helps. So what's the verdict? Is it really overrated? I think no. It is of real benefit where the traditional conventional methodology doesn't work. So there are newer microinvasive implants which we've already seen. So they can be used for mild to moderate glaucomas, and it decreases definitely reliance on medications without the safety risks of more invasive procedures like AJV. Thank you so much. Do we have any questions from the house? I think the next speakers are here. So thank you for being a part of this IC. And we had some great exchange of ideas and some nice discussions. Thanks a lot. I invite the next speakers on the podium. Thank you.